Hello, and welcome back to another episode with It's Dr. Dan, and today we're going to be learning about chemical bonding. So, what is chemical bonding? What is it all about? So, this is an introductory video just going over the different types of chemical bonds and how do we come across them? How do we label them? What do they look like? So, for this one, what exactly a bond is when two or more atoms combine where they form a bond, meaning that they have some type of force of attraction between them. Now, what is all the driving force between these? Why do they want to bond so badly? Well, one of the things that you've been learning about in your chemistry course is that most atoms, they do not have a complete outer shell, meaning that they aren't quite happy. They want to have all their electrons filled. They don't want to react. They want to be like a noble guest. The goal is to be dignified, just like a noble, when they look at these different elements. So how can you do that? Well, elements, what they're going to do, they're going to combine, meaning that when this happens, we will fill our valence level. Remember, valence is your highest quantum number, your outermost layer. Think of an onion. It's the outside of the onion. So now the goal is that you want to have 8 electrons for these elements. So many of them want to have 8. There are exceptions, which we'll talk about in other videos, but the goal is 8 for most of them. Now, how can they do it, though? How can they get to 8? Well, they can do all kinds of things. How can you try to get, let's say, if you want to think about money, how could you get there? Well, you could work for it. You could borrow it. You could take it. You could lose it. You could do all kinds of things with it. It's kind of the same idea with electrons. So what can they do is they could give their electrons away, meaning that that will get them to an octet, possibly. They could take electrons from other atoms, and generally it's like a bartering system. They'll be happy as well, so they don't mind losing them. So right, give and take. Or we can share, right? Now, each of these have their own benefits. Different types of atoms will do all these different reactions. So when we see this type of bonding that's occurring, well, we represent this either as compounds or as molecules. So you're going to hear your different professors and teachers using these words a lot, and it's going to get a little confusing. Keep in mind, they generally mean a very similar definition, but they do have a difference. So compounds are whenever you have two or more different types of atoms. Meaning, like, if you have a metal and a non-metal, or a metalloid and a non-metal, maybe, or generally metals and non-metals. So they're two different, completely different types of atoms. Now, what that means is all compounds are molecules here. So molecules, if you notice, are two or more atoms that are bonded. It doesn't matter what they are, as long as they're bonded. So you could have a metal and a metal, or a non-metal and a non-metal. You can have a metal and a non-metal, as long as they are bonded. So all compounds are molecules. So you'll hear that word kind of interchanged a lot. Usually, we use compounds to describe ionic species more often. Now, we'll talk about this throughout your course and all these videos for you to understand that. So what does that mean in the end is not all molecules are compounds. Remember, they have to be, in order to be a compound, they need to be two different types. That's the most important thing for this sentence. Compounds, not all of them are compounds. So compounds are generally metals and non-metals. All right, let's take a further look at these different. So there are generally three types of bonds that just as a general classification for general chemistry. The three of them are ionic, covalent, and metallic bonds. We're going to talk briefly about each one of them so you get a basic idea of what they look like. So ionic is when one atom donates an electron and the other one accepts. So it's that give and take. Now, when this happens, it's making an electrostatic attraction, meaning it's that positive and negative charge are being attracted to each other, okay? So positive and negative, right? So this is where your predictable ions are going to be very, very important. This is when metals act as what we call cations. So remember, cations are positive, and nonmetals act as anions, or as I like kind of sometimes say, as onions. So anion and cations. Now, these can exist in different subcategories. They can be type 1 or type 2. Now, type 1 means that the cation is predictable. It's something that always has the same charge no matter what. So it's usually one of the elements found in your first two columns of your periodic table, or maybe ammonium as a polyatomic, something that's always the same. Type 2 is when you have a variable charge, meaning that there is a transition metal that's bonding. Now, what do these guys look like? Well, ionic compounds are always, they exist as crystalline structures, meaning that if you've ever looked at, let's say you have table salt at home, so you salt different food dishes all the time, it's a crystal, right? It looks like a little rock that comes out of your container. If you look at it under a really powerful microscope, you actually will see the crystal structure. If you ever go to, let's say, a museum and you go to a geode exhibit, you'll also see that all the different rocks exist in crystalline structures as well. This is because they are ionic compounds that exist as a crystalline lattice, meaning that they exist in this repeating framework. So you have Na plus as yellow orbs here and chlorine minus as green, and you could see it's this alternating pattern. Now, the thing about this, though, is it's very hard to count the number of atoms in ions when you want to illustrate these. So generally, we like to simplify these to the simplest ratio. What we refer to this as is a formula unit. Okay, so that's the important word here. So now the good news is this formula unit is all based on your charges. So for example, if I have, let's say, Na and Cl here, remember from before, the goal was 8. So how do we get to 8 electrons? Well, what can happen is, remember, it's all about giving and taking. So sodium wants to give away its one electron here. So what will it become if it does that? Well, then we'll have Na plus, right? And if you remember from your predictable charges in the periodic table, that's exactly where that charge comes from. And then chlorine on the other side will now have a complete 8 electrons as a result. So we can now fill in that extra electron from sodium. And then we would write that in brackets with a negative charge to say, like, hey, this guy does have its complete negative charge. Sometimes this can also be written where the negative is inside the brackets as well. It generally depends on this notation, but this is a general notation where we use brackets to show that ion. So keep that in mind. We'll put that this is a general notation. So we're all about trying to give and take these different types of electrons as we are looking at these different species. Now, overall, when we write the final name for this, we would just write NaCl. And if you'd like to, you could label this as an ionic type 1 compound. And it's also considered a binary ionic compound. Binary meaning that there's two. So where do I get two from? There's an Na and a Cl. It's two. So type 1 is that they're predictable, being that they have a plus, as Na has a plus charge, and it always has a plus charge. Okay, so that's the general idea for ionic. Let's look at an example. I have an ionic compound here, which is a metal plus a nonmetal. So we have calcium, which is our metal, and fluorine, our nonmetal. So calcium, which is going to be our cation here, is going to be likely to give away its electrons to get 8. So when it gives away its electrons, it will give one away to each fluorine. And as a result, we will have calcium 2 plus. Okay, now what about all the fluorines? So what we're going to do is we're going to put the fluorines on each side here. And we're now going to draw in all the different electrons. So let's draw the ones that calcium gave first. And then we'll put the other 8 dots around this. And now we can see that we have a complete octet around fluorine, which makes it very, very happy. And then we also have a complete octet around calcium as well. Keep in mind that calcium does have a complete octet because it loses its outer shell electrons. just as a kind of quick reminder. So it loses its 4s2 electrons, and it will have a final configuration where essentially it will be equivalent to argon for its electron configuration, for those of you who are learning about that. So its final valence level will now be 3s2, 3p6, and you can write that it has a neon over here, so which is argon. Okay, so it also has those 8 valence electrons. Let's take a look at covalent bonding to learn about the next type. So covalent bonding is all about sharing of electrons, meaning we try to make this as equal of a partnership as possible. Now, keep in mind, sometimes this is not always the most equal. You can also have a little bit, maybe it lean one way or the other, but let's just for now keep it simple. It's about equal. So the way that this works instead is that each one of these will kind of come in. So I'll bring a hydrogen on each side and we literally share our electrons. So as a result, hydrogen has a complete external layer and so does oxygen. They equally share all those electrons that are around it. So if you kind of can notice, oxygen has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And hydrogen is one of those exceptions where it can only actually have only 2. So everything is happy. So generally the way that we will kind of illustrate this as a happy bond for covalent is we'll draw a line to illustrate that we have a bond. So if we move all these different species, we'll get rid of these electrons here, and we will write a line to represent a chemical bond. So this is a covalent bond. This represents that 2 electrons are being shared amongst that bond. So now what species participate in this is generally anything referred to as molecular, so or like a molecule. Also binary acids and oxy acids as well fall under covalent as well. But the main one here is anything that's molecular is what you are looking for labeling these. We refer to covalent generally as molecules, whereas ionic is generally your compounds, being that these are both the hydrogen and oxygen are both nonmetals, right? They're the same type. Let's look at the last one. So metallic bonds, which generally does not come up a lot in like introductory chemistry, or sometimes it comes up maybe by general chemistry too. You'll see metallic bonds when you're learning about like maybe coordinate chemistry. But it's something that doesn't get talked about a lot unless you're taking a lot of physics or engineering, maybe some very heavy duty bonding courses, or in if you're trying to learn about semiconductors. So what it is atoms that are connected via a sea of electrons, meaning that this is between metals only. So what do I mean by that sea of electrons? Well, let's say I have this water bucket here and it's made of iron. Well, all the iron that's in this, all the different atoms that are in it are giving off electrons. They willingly are giving them away. So because of that, it's causing all of them to have a very, very strong bond amongst themselves. So this is just more of a demonstration just to see kind of what this is like, where there's all kinds of wild physics phenomenon that can happen because of this sea of electrons with different types of different unit quantum type units. But just keep in mind metallic bonds occur between metals. That's all we need to know for this video. Okay, so this was the 3 different types of bonding. I hope this video helped. Please feel free to watch my follow-up video on how to interpret a chemical bond or a chemical formula so you know how to read them. There will be more videos to come soon, and thank you all so much for listening. I hope you have a wonderful day, and please hit that like and subscribe button if you haven't, and I will see you all later. Bye now.